In 1945, Jean Dubuffet draws Pis sur un mur. At the forefront are two men urinating on a towering wall, a wall whose tiny motifs tell a quaint story about 1945 Paris. The year, merde, and a declaration of love between Lucien and Emile. A new urban, weird, and wild energy. Fast forward 30 years to 1978 New York, a city convulsed by violent crime and on the brink of financial ruin. There, Jean-Michel Basquiat, a teenage artist, has just moved from Brooklyn to Manhattan. For his first major exhibition, New York New Wave, Basquiat used found trash from around his urban environment, perhaps scrap metal, foam mattress, or chipboard as the support for 26 new works which jostle with the noise of Manhattan life, where letters cascade over sprawled cars, airplanes, and skyscrapers. The critics immediately saw a parallel to Dubuffet's career, presumably thinking of his bustling Metro series or the cartoonish cars in his Paris circus works. And in Art Forum December 1981, the provocative poet Rene Ricard wrote a piece, The Radiant Child, about Basquiat, where he commented,
"If Cy Twombly and Jean Dubuffet had a baby and then gave it up for adoption, it would be Jean-Michel. The elegance of Twombly is there, and so is the brute of the young Dubuffet."
The critics were onto something. Firstly, both Dubuffet and Basquiat shared quite an anti-authoritarian spirit. They set out to dismantle what had gone before, the polite easel painting of Beaux-Arts Paris and the cool minimalism that reigned in New York. And neither one chose to pursue a formal art education either. Both Dubuffet and Basquiat were each drawn to self-taught artists, Dubuffet collecting what he called art brut, including work by children, spiritualists, and psychiatric patients. They also produced their work similarly too, at times painting with their canvases positioned directly on the studio floor. But perhaps most importantly is that each were invested in the idea of truth beyond resemblance, the idea that while a work of art could be perfectly accurate and realistic, it may in no way capture spirit. In other words, works could ring with truth and electricity through doodles and representations that appeared to the eyes as anything but real. They did this by looking for modes of painting that would give a work the impression of life, as if it had a pulse of its own, which is not such an easy thing to do. Strangely, when once asked, Basquiat denied any knowledge of Dubuffet at all. Now, Jean-Michel may have simply been uninterested in indulging that question, but taking his words as truth, perhaps he adopted Dubuffet inspiration by way of Cy Twombly instead. Once, when reading Life magazine, Twombly found a Dubuffet piece, ripped it out, and from then would paint with it kept in his studio. However it came, by the mid-80s, Basquiat was not only familiar with Dubuffet's work, he was an avid admirer. He asked the founder of Pace Gallery, Arnie Glimcher, if he might be allowed to visit the gallery when they were installing Dubuffet exhibitions, so that he could just sit with the work for a few hours. More direct allusions began to appear in Basquiat's painting, such as the perilously high horizon line of King Zulu, 1986, or Pegasus, 1987, a motif likely borrowed from Dubuffet's 1950s landscapes. A monochromatic passage from 1952 was once exhibited at the Museum of Modern Art in 1987, which could have been a direct reference in Basquiat's Pegasus. With all they have in common, the world may never know if the two artists even ever met, but they did exhibit side by side on at least one occasion during their lifetimes, an expressive painting after Picasso at the Beiler Foundation in Basel, which also featured the work of Jackson Pollock, Willem de Kooning, and Joan Miró. Basquiat was only 22, while Dubuffet was a stately 82. That their work could stand up alongside one another's despite a 60-year age gap is a testament to the former's prodigious talents and the latter's relentless invention. Today, someone is just as likely to learn about Dubuffet via Basquiat as vice versa, which feels a truer reflection of their relationship, not as artistic parent and child, but as intellectual companions who wanted to capture the chaos of the mind and both believed in the alchemical power of painting to do so.